everybody. It's Dr. Carmen Bryan. Welcome back to my YouTube channel. This is Overcoming Narcissist Abuse. Thank you guys so much to all the new subscribers that has joined this tribe. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for finding something relevant that I have to say concerning either your situation, more information that you need, your plans to escape, or your plan of recovery. And so thank you so much. I'm always honored, and it's always a great privilege. And so today's, today's episode, I wanted to talk about the narcissist versus a computer virus. And so most of you are like, okay, what is she getting ready to say, right? So those of you that are computer, those are techies, those are computer programmers, you'll kind of understand, you know, to give a different perspective of how this narcissist operates. And those of you, you know, when you have people that are in the computer programming and the language, it has its own language, culture, you know, if you listen to computer programmers or those that are into computer systems and building computers, they have a whole language that we don't understand. There's a whole language written, codes that are languages that tells the computers what to do, and they have a whole sense of humor that most of us don't understand. Likewise, a person that's in the medical field understands how the body operates. A person that's in the mental health field knows how the mind or the emotions operate, you know, so each one of us are skilled in particular areas and have our particular language. And so when you're dealing with a computer, and based on as much knowledge as I have about it, which is just not a whole lot, because I'm not a techie, and so I have the millennials teaching me about the computer system, not computer, but programs and stuff. But you know, you have the computer. So someone, you know, if for those that are not in the computers, it's a complex system. You know, we don't care about all the background stuff. We let you guys handle that. We just want to make sure that when we hit the key, stuff works. And so you have an operating system. This is the main brain of your computer, the operating system. This is the main computer. This is the brain, the communication center. You know, that is it's like in the military. You know, you have the company that's out on the war field, and in the middle you have the command center, which is where the whole operation takes place. The commanding officer, the first sergeant or sergeant major, you know, the general officers, the, you know, whoever these battle-trained individuals are that work in this mainframe where everything, all the commands come from, all the thoughts and plans and strategic plans take place where they're watching. So this is the command center. Likewise with a computer, you know, that operating system is the command center of that computer. And so when you add programs such as Microsoft Office, you have your Word documents, your Excel, if you add Adobe on there, you know, you have your systems that operate, you know, you have to add that on there in order to do like music or recording. You have other stuff on there, you know, the internet and everything. But when you're hitting those keys, that main operating system is always running in the background. It has its language and colors, and this is where all this information is coming from. And even when you buy these programs, the software to upload into the computer, that brain is still operating because there's stuff that needs to be done and they're communicating together. And so everyone that invests in a good computer, gaming computers, you know, work computers, especially those large corporations like the military invest in computer system, and most of that is Microsoft, but that invest in these computers, they have to invest in a very good antivirus program. And the military spends millions of dollars in making sure they protect their assets, protect the computer system and the information that's in the computer systems, making sure personnel are trained and they have the correct security clearances. Sorry, you got a nose itching. But have the correct security clearances, and with the security clearances is still, you know, on a need to know basis. Personnel, people that have to protect personal information and social security numbers, you know, but you know, these people are trained, but they have a very good antivirus and program set in there to protect the information that's on there. Well, if you think of a narcissist as a virus, you know, we can look at, you know, people that create viruses also are people that have different agendas on their mind. There are different things that they're trying to do. Some people create viruses in order to steal your identity off the computer system. You know, they send the viruses out. You can click on a link, and that link will open up the virus where it starts going through your system very fast, sometimes before that antivirus can catch up with it. You know, and that's why investing in a good antivirus program it stays up to date because millions of viruses are created daily, every day. And so that system has to be updated constantly to ensure that it catches up with the latest virus, almost like moment to moment, play by play, you know, to protect you. You know, they quarantine it to check it to make sure that, you know, that's not a virus. You catch it, quarantine, you know, and if it gets on the loose inside of your system, you know, it begins to duplicate, it begins to hack, it begins to maybe duplicate passwords, keystrokes, you know. For some, they're about identity theft. So they're looking at your keystrokes, they're looking at passwords that you're putting into your personal accounts. You know, where do you have accounts? You know, what are your passwords? Others, you know, they go through your system, they begin to tear down your files, and their whole focus is that main operating system. They destroy that main operating system. A lot of times, once it's hacked and they get the information that they need, immediately they go in and destroy that operating system so you can't recover anything either. You know, that's how bad it can get damaged. Well, based on what I know, a lot of times you can recover stuff off of that, but it's infected. You know, infected meaning if they put it on another computer, it'll tear that computer up too. But they move so quickly. Others, you know, the malicious, you know, when I was in the military, we worked with a lot of, you know, when we're dealing with our computer systems, they have a whole unit set aside, or, you know, their civilian personnel that deal specifically with computers and making sure that the military computers are running safely. And so when we have a technical issue or a problem on our system, or there's stuff that's uploading, because every night we have to take our cards out, leave the computer on, because at night is when these technicians go in, or like the Department of the Army would send out a update on all the computers. So all the computers are updating at the same time. And so when you come in the morning, your computer has been updated. You know, you go back and log in and stuff, you know. But when we were on a lot of times we had the personnel on base. We would take the computers over there, or they may come to the office. And sometimes we'd actually have to call other technicians that would actually go on the computer. You're on the phone with them, and then they ask you for the IP address. And they were able to duplicate, they were able to tap into your computer where your screen shows up on their screen, and they're doing work on your computer. Some viruses are set up like that as duplicators. They're backdoor hackers. They duplicate, they mimic you as if it's you, but you can sit there and you watch this technician all over your screen, just going everywhere, and then you have no control. You can't take control over that mouse. It won't work because they have total control over your screen, over your computer system. Well, narcissists operate the exact same way. You know, a narcissist finds opportunity. They're opportunists. They find opportunity, and depending on the type of narcissist that they are, they find opportunity in the area that they find opportunity. That's why some of you are like, I don't understand. You know, I'm this beautiful model, I'm this whatever, and they found a crackhead with one tooth. You know, or I can't believe this. You know, they found this individual. We had a job, we had these beautiful homes, and this person is out of prison or in prison, or, you know, doesn't have anything, can't even speak, you know, a whole sentence together. You know why? Our narcissists are people of opportunity. Now, when you have somatic narcissists, you know, those that are very into their images and stuff, a lot of that stuff right there you may not see or ever hear about. But they are opportunists. And so if they connect with someone, they've been studying the whole time. And they put those little, you know, those little signals out there. They throw those little carrots out there to see if you will bite, to see if you are a superficial individual, to see where you are hurting at, to see where there's an open door. And, you know, if they can get you to bite, you know, if you look too long, or if you hold a conversation too long, you know, they listen to the information that you're giving, and they begin to duplicate. They begin to mirror. They begin to learn your language. They begin to learn your moves, your how you think, what you do, what is of value to you. Because most of you realize that now that that narcissist is out of your life, what do they normally attack? They attack whatever is of value to you. They always, you know, your children, they try to attack your children, but they attack the children in order to hurt you, because they know that your value is with your children. If you know, the fact that you have built a retirement, built a nice little nest egg, you know, they're after that money, first of all, for themselves, but to make sure that you don't have anything, you know, but anything that they can find, you know, to enter in. And really their whole goal is to destroy you as a person. And when I say destroy you as a person, there's no way a virus can live inside of a computer and not destroy the computer. You know, when you have a virus on this computer, eventually it's going to crash. When you are connected with a narcissist, when you are connected to a narcissist, eventually you are going to crash. Now, the way on a computer that you see something is not right, all of a sudden, you know, the computer starts running slow. You know, all of a sudden, you know, certain programs, you can't find them. You click on something, something doesn't work. You're like, oh, I need to reset it. And every time you reset it, you come back, there's something, something's not right. You may not be computer savvy, but you do know that something is not right. Something is going on this computer. And until you talk to someone else that may have had the same experience or may have experience working on computers or have gotten information from a computer tech or is a computer tech, usually they'll start asking you questions. Well, is it doing this? Is it doing this when you click on this or when you turn it off or when you do this right here? Or do you have an antivirus on there? What kind do you have? When was the last time it was updated? You know, do you have this right here? So they're asking questions. Well, likewise with a narcissist. Oftentimes, you don't know what is going on, but you know something is just not right. Go with your intuition. Go with your gut instinct. Go with your discernment, you know, but you know something is not right. Something, and all of a sudden, you're not functioning like you used to. All of a sudden, you're sluggish. You're fatigued. You look in the mirror and you look at a picture of yourself from back in the day before you met that narcissist. You were healthy. Your skin was healthy. You were vibrant. You were thin. And now you 5 million pounds. You know, you were big, and all of a sudden you look anorexic. You know, your face looked like it's aged. Your skin looks bad. Your health is bad. Your breath is bad. Believe it or not, sometimes you get sick to a point where you are just, and people looking like, I don't recognize you. You don't recognize you. Sometimes you won't look at yourself, but you don't even recognize you because that he has or she has gotten into your system and begin affecting that system. Most people, when they reach out and they have made a decision to, well, not everybody, but they have made a decision that I'm just going to stay. They've given up the fight. They're not going to go anywhere. So Dr. C, I need you to help me to, first of all, help me with stress management. Help me to be able to survive and make it and flourish. And you know, the sad part about it is that as long as you're connected with a narcissist, you're not. This is all you... One thing that a therapist can tell you is that I will always have my bills paid dealing with an individual that chooses not to leave a narcissistic relationship, because whether it's me or whether it's anybody else that you go to for counseling, if you choose to stay, there's nothing, you know, I need stress management. Okay, I'll help you to learn how to relax and everything. But what happens when it comes back again? Because it's not going to stop. So you're always in there breathing and hama nama nama and rubbing your ears. But you have to sometimes remove the source of the stress, remove the source of the torment, remove the source of the, and I know, well, I'm not ready and I don't know how I'm going to do this. You know what? It's better to leave and hurt from the healing process and from the memories than to stay and slowly begin to die, slowly begin to deteriorate, slowly begin to wither away, slowly begin to lose hope where you just believe this is how life is. There's something that my mentor said last night during Bible study. I was in Bible study, and it's something that just really resonated with me because it was so prevalent to, you know, dealing with narcissists and those of you that have come from toxic families and narcissistic families. We have a beautiful lady who is just a mother to everyone, and she has a beautiful little girl who was born with club feet. So, you know, the club feet are turned in like this, and so they had been doing a lot of work to turn the feet back around, but the doctor has finally made a decision that they have to do surgery to turn the feet around. Well, the baby is now beginning to walk, and trying to walk, and but it's really unhealthy for the baby to walk because the feet are turning back in. And so, excuse me, guys, but the feet, you know, the baby is walking on trying to walk on the ankles, which is very, very painful. And what she said to my pastor and what my pastor said over the pulpit, and I kind of have to paraphrase, is that, you know, all she's ever known is pain. And so she's trying to walk on pain, so that's all she knows. And so her body is always adjusting to look for that pain because that's what she's accustomed to. You know, her feet are accustomed to pain. That's all she knows. And so the high level of pain that she is in is unbearable to most people, but to her, that's her norm. And that is a lot of times the situation with people coming out of narcissistic relationships with their families or in relation, well, in families that have narcissistic family members, mother, father, grandmother, you know, siblings, whatever, you know, abusive homes, rejectful, all you are accustomed to is emotional pain, physical pain. There are some women that I have met that, you know, don't believe a man loves them unless he's hurting them. Doesn't believe that a man loves them unless they're angry or yelling at them. Doesn't believe that a man, they are addicted to the pain, meaning that you don't care for me unless you are hurting me, because that's all that they're accustomed to. That is their norm. And likewise, you know, with the computer viruses, once they get into your system, it's hard to get them out of your system. Even after you leave the narcissist, you're still dealing with the residue and the residuals of having to rebuild the program. You know, you can have a, you know, someone goes in to fix the computer system, right? 9 times out of 10, when they go in to fix your computer system, they have to go in and wipe everything off the computer. A lot of times you cannot get back the stuff that was on there. You can't restore it. You can't find it. It's lost and it's infected. So what they have to do is they have to wipe the whole system and then put those programs back on, reapply those programs back on. So you basically have a new computer, but everything that you had that was in that computer is basically lost, and you have to rebuild the computer, rebuild, you know, what you've worked on. Likewise, for many of you guys that have been affected with a narcissistic relationship, a lot of things when you get out, your slate has to be wiped clean. You have to let it go. Some things that you try to hold on to are infected. And if you hold on to those things from the narcissist or try to hold on to that narcissist, assuming that you can have some type of normalcy, normal conversation, normal co-parenting, you know, and counter-parenting, which many of you guys, you know, unfortunately are stuck in because the court of law says so, you know, but at the same time, there is no normalcy. And a lot of things you have to let go, close the doors and move forward and start all over again, building yourself back up. And that is a very painful process when there's a lot that was at stake and a lot that was lost. But much rather lose material things, you know, than to lose your life and lose your mind. Because once you lose your mind, it's very hard to get your mind back. And there are a lot of people I can only imagine that are in, like here we have Western State Hospital, in mental health institutes that have totally lost their minds and have gone have catatonic or have gone a complete psychotic breakdown where they are no longer in their right mind. They're no longer, and it's only, I can only imagine like picking their minds and looking into their brains to see what did you go through that caused you to be so stressed that your mind totally shut down like a computer system that is so bad, that virus was so bad, it shut the whole system down. So I'm telling you, no contact and get out of the relationship. But be wise, because many of you give advice like get out and go right now. For some people, there's entirely too much invested. So it is important that you do the wise thing by seeking legal counsel. Because in a lot of states, you know, when you're dealing with children, especially, you know, mothers and fathers have rights to the children. And so to jump up and leave with those children can be considered kidnapping or abandonment. You're leaving and leaving the kids, abandonment. And so you have to make sure you get legal counsel, legal advice, you know, or you use like a domestic violence center or the YWCA in your local area. And for some, if the abuse is bad enough, they'll actually relocate you, change your identity, you know, but they will protect you under law in order to protect you from your abuser. And you may have to, even if it is giving up everything and moving into a shelter and having to start from ground zero, at least you know that it was your hands that rebuilt that foundation. It's you, and you have more value over what you are building, and it'll become harder for people to hack. And then you'll invest in an antivirus, a good plan, being very aware. You know, things that you learn from having viruses on your computer is that when you get an email that says, hey, contact me, I'm in wherever I'm at, and we think we have an inheritance, someone left an inheritance with your name, you know doggone well you don't have anybody living in Australia or in Africa or in China. You an African American, or you a Brazilian, you know you don't have any relatives in China. Who's sending you some information from over there? When did you have Mongolian in your family? You know that you don't have no family members. Well, maybe. Well, you know, if you contact us, you know, we have this check waiting for you. And then here you're stuck in this scam where they've got your card and everything. And so we become wiser, where now we begin to delete. We begin to recognize phishing, where, you know, phishing, you know, the spamming, well, not spamming, but phishing. PH, you know, not phishing, but PH, you know, phishing schemes where they're phishing for information. Hey, you know, we've got an alert on your account from Bank of America or whatever bank you're from that there's been some fraudulent activity. Go in and change your password. So all of a sudden they're asking you for your name, date, your birth date, your ancestry.com, your DNA, your fingerprint, you know, and all of a sudden now money, thousands and millions of dollars have been stolen and everything. So sometimes we learn a heart. Sometimes we learn from other people watching television. And then sometimes we learn from experience. And so you have now got an antivirus. You have more information to safeguard yourself. Well, you know, with narcissism, you have more information now to safeguard yourself. So hopefully I hope this video has helped you guys, giving you a different perspective and a different analogy of what is actually happening when you're dealing with a narcissist. Please subscribe to my channel. It is Dr. Carmen Bryant, Overcoming Narcissist Abuse. Thank you all for all of your support, emails, and even those that I've gotten an opportunity, you know, even though it's like a one-time opportunity where you just needed some information, needed some encouragement, needed to set up some goals. I am so truly honored. I'm really thinking about leaving it at the discount because it's some really good turnaround. You know, even though I have a full schedule, I do like to put people in, you know, make sure I leave some availability. So for some of you guys that need some help just kind of moving forward and checking in with me every now and then, is really have been really successful. I'm so honored because I get to see faces. I get to talk to people face to face, and I get to see who's behind the names on YouTube. And it is truly, truly been an honor. Thank you so much for trusting me. And make sure you go check out my mentor's YouTube channel. It is Helen Sadler, Destiny Helper. And do know that I do have a book out. You go on Amazon or Barnes & Noble. It is Unmasking the Illusion of Perfection. And it is true stories about people that have gone through narcissist abuse, how they were groomed, how their parents, grandparents, family members, you know, things that were said, you know, things that they were thinking when they were going through, when they escaped, some of the things that the narcissist was doing. I wanted to do another one because I really wanted parents to be aware of, you know, the narcissists that are also pedophiles and how they groom your kids. And sometimes, sad to say, those that are grooming your kids are actually the mother and father of the children or step parents of the children. And sometimes people are so desperate to be in a relationship that you totally forget to antivirus your children, you know, and sometimes you are so stuck in your pain and your hurt, which is legitimate, that you forget that you have a child that you need to protect and is vulnerable to that narcissist. And a narcissist takes every opportunity, you know, any opportunity, especially if they're also a pedophile. They take any opportunity that they can. Some are more obvious and some are not obvious. And some parents, and a lot of times I deal with women like that, that are so desperate for a mate that they have presented this beautiful, charming, you know, you've been so wounded that this narcissist presents himself in a way that you are just flabbergasted. And really, your money, your time, your youth, your status, your children have become a target. And so I am going to talk about that because I think is really relevant for us to discuss that as well. And for children, not children, but like teens, if you have teens that you want to hear me talk about, it may, you know, for them to get some red flags, you know, about their parents, mother or father, because women sexually abused just like men sexually abused. And not everybody that has been sexually abused become sexual abusers or pedophiles. But 9 times out of 10, if you go look at a person that is conducting, you know, is doing the sexual abuse, probably has been abused themselves. It's a learned behavior, you know, and so, and that's what they do. And so I will make a video on that. Please look up underneath my link. Those of you that, you know, a lot of you are in need of counseling. You really need to be into some type of counseling to help you through this process. PTSD, you know, finding a good counselor you can talk to. And these are people that are video conference. You know, you could talk to people that are telephonic. It's very convenient. Many people have given some really great reviews about BetterHelp.com. You go BetterHelp.com/Dr. Carmen, you get a 10% 10% discount. When you click on it, I actually put the description of what you're looking for. Someone that specializes in narcissist abuse, you know, you can vet the counselor, ask them what they know about, you know, a psychological abuse, abuse, you know, your children, and you talk to somebody. You need, don't be ashamed. I think I was watching the Ricky Smiley morning show, and he said the same thing, and it's really great to hear a black man. You know, a lot of times there's a big stigma when you're dealing with men in general, but even a black man in general, you know, that doesn't want to go to counseling. And he says, you know, with him being a father, him being, you know, in the, he's a comic, you know, he's doing radio and everything, and he really advocated for counseling. You know, don't be ashamed. He has a counselor because he has a lot on his plate that he has to deal with, you know, especially with grief. And a lot of you guys are going through grief and loss dealing with these narcissists, but he really advocated for us counselors. And I'm really appreciative of that, because there is no shame in going to talk to someone when you can't figure it out. You've been trying to do it all this time, and you seem to be failing miserably. So if you keep doing the same thing, thinking you can give yourself counseling, you know, you failing already. You know, and so I really advocate counseling, and I'm glad that he did that on one of his shows as well. You know, Oprah, I think she talked about, Ms. Oprah Winfrey, she talked about it before. Don't be ashamed to get counseling. If you can't leave your house at this particular time, go to betterhelp.com/Dr. Carmen. And for those of you that have asked, I do have a Cash App and a PayPal if you want to donate. It helps to keep, you know, my research and trying to do these books and travel, you know, and just be prepared, you know, with travel schedule. I will let you guys know. Thank you so, so much, and I hope you guys have a beautiful weekend. I may try to come on tomorrow to do that, because that's really on my mind, because I'm hearing too many stories, you know, and people have disclosed information that really makes me want to talk about this, so that you parents can be more aware of these narcissists that are actually also pedophiles, and how they're targeting your kids. And a lot of times you're so swept up by their beauty and their glamour and their charm, and then you're hurt when they leave, and you leave and you run right into another one, and you leaving the kids very vulnerable to these attacks. And so please, you know, look out for your babies. Even though you are hurting, look out for your kids, because your kids need attention. And when they feel rejected and abandoned, they gravitate to people that show them attention. And isn't that what the narcissist does? The narcissist gives this pseudo attention and make them feel wonderful. And so we're going to talk about that on another video. And thank you guys so much. I'm on Podbean. I do have podcasts where I started off from scratch. Go to Podbean, Overcoming Narcissist Abuse, and go check out some of those recordings, those podcasts that I did. I'm back on. I got to get back on the grind, you know, after the holidays and trying to catch up on paperwork. But thank you guys for being so patient with me, and you guys go and be great.